All right, Steve, we're here recording a special episode of the Steel Target Paint podcast. We're going to dedicate this episode to talking about the new peak times that have been set for Steel Challenge. How do you think about that?
Jeff, I'm looking forward to it. Man, why did I ever decide to shoot Open Division? Jeez and Pete's.
Well, you know, right. Now that you mentioned that, let's get right into it. I've got the times here in front of me, and I put them in a little spreadsheet. And let's start right out with two of the divisions that don't get shot that much, but they still get shot, and that's the Revolver Division. Interestingly enough, the Iron Sight Revolver Division not changing at all as far as the overall time, because two stages actually got slower and two stages got faster. So they it's still 103 seconds for Iron Sight Revolver, but like I said, Outer Limits and Pendulum, they actually got slower. What do you think about that? I know you don't shoot Iron Sight Revolver, but what do you think about those changes?
Hey, based on what the changes are to the Open Division, I may have to get my revolver work done so I can start shooting Iron Sight Revolver. That one didn't change. I think it's very appropriate. Pendulum's a little bit of a slower stage. Same thing with Outer Limits. And then, of course, Accelerator. I know I've been shooting that a lot better and a lot faster. And same thing with Roundabout. So I think it's a pretty good move.
Yeah, same here. Now, with the Optical Sight Revolver, three of the stages got faster, but one got slower, and oddly enough, it was Roundabout. And everybody's going to say, you know, how does Roundabout get slower? Well, for those that don't know, Zach Jones and I worked on this, and we took data from major matches, including the last two world speed shoots, to determine whether or not there was an appropriate changes that need to be made. And I guess Optical Sight Revolver, they have trouble with Roundabout. So that got a little slower.
All right, let's move on to Limited Division, Jeff. It looks like that one got a little bit quicker.
Yeah. You know, I once asked, or Zach Jones once asked me to guess what the, I think he even did it on our podcast, you know, what's the most shot division? And it turns out to be Limited. And I think this is why we're seeing this stage go down, because a lot of people are shooting and a lot of people are getting fast. You got BJ and Jesse and a number of others that are out there shooting Limited crazy fast time. So I think that's what caused this one to get the half second change on every stage.
Yeah, dropping 4 seconds for a peak time in a division, that's pretty assertive. Thanks, BJ. We appreciate that.
Well, you know, moving on to production. Yeah, it's not much better. That's going down 3.5 seconds overall. The only one, oddly enough, that it's not changing is Accelerator.
No, those are some pretty good times. A lot of the fast shooters out there, the Grandmasters, are definitely shooting Showdown, Smoke and Hope, and Roundabout in 10 seconds or 95% of that. That's in that 10.5 range. So I think that's probably a good adjustment.
Again, I think production is another one of those old school, been around forever, a lot of people shooting it, and a lot of people getting good at it. And so, again, I think that the numbers reflect. Now, rounding out the center fire division, a lot of people notice that there's no carry optics and there's no single stack changes. And I will tell you that when we looked at the data, there just wasn't enough shooters that have shot that making Grandmaster times to warrant a change. So single stack is not changing. And Steve, I think you shoot single stack, don't you? So you got to be happy about that.
I knew it was a positive sign with my $100 check cleared from Zach Jones. So thank you, Zach, for not making any changes to single stack division, because I'm going to need another year to hit that Grandmaster. At least that's my plan.
Oh, that's awesome.
Wow, Jeff. One of the fastest divisions out there. Certainly the fastest center fire division. Open Division went from a peak time of 86 seconds to 84. Wow, that is smoking fast. We were talking to Max Michel a week or two ago. He shot a 74. So in order to become a Grandmaster, you're going to have to shoot, what's that, sub 9 on Roundabout with a peak time of 8.5. Smoke and Hope is 8.5. Some blistering times out there. Outer Limits is down half of a second. Accelerator, interestingly enough, went up half of a second. Pendulum, Max's favorite stage, it's a personal favorite of mine as well, went down half a second. Yeah, he's probably swerving off the road if he's listening to this podcast, driving his vehicle and his family around. Speed option went down half of a second. Showdown went up half of a second. Five to go went down a half. So there's a couple, I think, more reasonable times there. But boy, oh boy, those sub-10-second runs or 10-second stages are going to be tough to obtain.
But, you know, you mentioned Max, and we really appreciated him being on our podcast. And I was just listening to the American Warrior podcast, and he was on there talking about Steel Challenge. And he said something on that podcast that he didn't say on ours. They got a little more detail into how he shoots the stages. But he says, you know, in the open division, half of the time you spend on the stage tends to be on your draw.
Yeah.
And it's very apparent that the draw is very important in those stages. And, you know, these guys are getting faster and faster, and they're getting faster draws, and they're getting faster transitions. I mean, there's some young kids. I think we've mentioned Christian Saylor. I mean, he just turned 18, and he's holding his own with those guys.
Yeah, he's
in the open division.
He's a beast out there.
Yeah.
So. And, you know, when you start really breaking it down, Jeff, I mean, the open division, if you look at Outer Limits, the peak time is 12.5 seconds, so we only keep three strings there. That's 4.16 seconds. That's not too bad. And if you multiply that by 5%, so it's about 4.38 seconds. You know, a lot of the fast rimfire folks are shooting that right at 4 seconds, so first shot's about 0.7. you need another, you know, 0.3, 0.4 with a really solid draw. I think it's obtainable, but it's just amazing. It's amazing how fast these times are really getting. More and more people are shooting them.
Well, you know, I haven't done them with the new changes that are coming across, but prior to these changes, which, again, for everybody, don't take effect until the first of the year, I looked at the difference between rimfire pistol open and open. And when you did the math, what you ended up having to do was whatever your draw was, if you said your transitions were going to be the same, which is a big wish, because let's face it, transitioning an open gun and transitioning a rimfire rifle very different. You only gained 0.375 seconds. So if you had a 0.6 draw, which, let's face it, rimfire pistol is pretty darn fast,
right?
You still had to have a sub-1 second draw to maintain and still do the same transitions to maintain the same relative time. That's how fast open is.
Yeah, it's a very, very fast division. Hey, Jeff, before we get too far into the other divisions, PCC and the rimfire divisions, you said something that sparked a comment. So I already had somebody reach out to me via social media and ask a very important question that I'm sure lots of people that haven't shot USPSA or much Steel Challenge, because this is really the most significant change we've seen in the peak time since 2 years ago when we started this program, is if I'm a grandmaster today, Jeff, and my peak time goes down into, let's just say, PCCO, so pistol carbine open, and the peak time's dropping by 4 seconds. I know I said we're going to talk about that here in a second, but yeah, that's my favorite division, so let's talk about it. If now the peak time has changed in such a manner that my fastest classification times or stage times that have been calculated now put me at a master, Jeff, do you know the answer to that question? If I'm a grandmaster today and my times remain the same and the peak time goes down and now it puts me in master, does my classification change or do I retain my GM status?
You will retain your GM status. So, in fact, this is exactly happening to me with rimfire pistol iron sight. I'm currently at 97% GM. After the changes, I'll be at 93%, but I will still retain my GM classification. And, of course, my ego won't let me have a 93% GM, so I'll have to go out and shoot the gun and get to 95.
That's right.
Now, you will retain your classification. So again, while the peak times are changing, classification will stay the same. The percentage, of course, will go down, and then everybody gets to work towards getting them back up to where they want them to be.
Also, Jeff, as a small aside for those folks that have not shot USPSA before, is there a way, if I'm a GM today and I have some sort of physical change, maybe there's unfortunate things that happen to great people all the time, and let's say if I'm in a car wreck and something happens to my shooting hand and now I have to shoot left-handed and I'm no longer able to compete at a grandmaster level, is there a way for me to downgrade my classification?
Yes, in both the USPSA and Steel Challenge, you can petition the board to have your classification changed based on a situation. In the case you gave, you know, I was a right-handed shooter and I can no longer use my right hand, but I'm still going to compete with my left hand. You could petition for that. I know in USPSA, I know as people get older, there's, you know, some guys that maintain their GM classification well into their 80s, but some guys say, you know, I don't feel competitive anymore. I'd like to be bumped down a class, and they will take that into consideration. And then if they deem appropriate, we'll make the changes.
Great. So hopefully a handful of folks that have that question, same rules apply as USPSA.
Correct.
All right, Jeff, let's go on to PCCO, the open division.
Well, just like limited, every stage is changing. They're all getting that half second. This is a very popular division, and again, I think people are pushing the limits. I'm not sure what Casey shot at Worlds, but it was sub-70. I know you've shot some sub-70s, as have a number of other people, and so everybody doing so well is driving this one down. Again, it's going from 78 seconds down to 74.
Yeah, I think the couple of fastest times that I've seen shot, I've shot sub-68 twice, and I think Casey either shot a high 67 or shot a low 68 at the World match. And so, you know, it was just, 2 years ago, I think the person that won the World Speed Shoot shot a 80-point-something. So the times have continued to drop the more popularity this division is. And, you know, I'm thinking what's going to happen is the gap's going to continue to close between PCC and Rimfire Rifle Open.
I agree with that, Steve, and I think there's one other thing that's also changing this sport, and that is there are now companies that are designing ammo specifically for Steel Challenge, and they are coming up with loads that run the gun, but, you know, we don't have a power factor in Steel Challenge, so as long as your gun cycles, you're okay, and a lot of these guns, you know, you shoot a JP, I shoot a Lead Star. There's a lot of SIG MPXs out there. The technology is getting better and better, making those guns shoot softer. And a softer shooting gun is going to be a faster shooting gun.
Yeah, you're exactly right, Jeff. And you're kind of freaking me out a little bit. Were you at my home range spying on me the other day? you know what I was doing? I was doing some more load development testing for my JP PCC.
Yeah.
So, I've got a strong partner, MD Ammo, Michael and Don are great people, and we're kind of pushing the limits a little bit, not getting it too slow and too sluggish. I want something that's firm and crisp because I just installed the new JP short stroke SCS, and man, it's definitely a noticeable difference. The gun just feels a lot sharper, a lot crisper. They took something that's really, really good, and I think they've made it great. And so I'm tweaking the loads just a little bit to see if I can get just a little bit more edge out of it.
Excellent. Well, you know, again, we talked about the centerfire state divisions that are not on the list, and you'll notice that pistol caliber carbine iron sight is not in the list. Again, that is due to the amount of data. There's actually only this past World Shoot is the first time that PCCI was ever shot. And again, we didn't think that one data set of 1 year was worth changing it. So hopefully we'll have more people shooting that in the coming years and make any adjustments that need to happen.
All right, Jeff, let's move on to the second fastest division out there, Rimfire Rifle Open.
Steve, I know this is another one that's near and dear to your heart, but guess what? 4 seconds, half second of stage.
And I think, you know, previous comments that this division specifically has dropped significantly in the amount of people that are shooting low 70s or even sub 70. We talked a little bit about it on a previous podcast. You know, if you go back to the World Speed Shoot, I think Ethan threw down a 64. But the amount of people under 70 seconds, it went from one or two to maybe 10. Same thing as Steel Nationals. There was, you know, a litany of people that were right at 70 or sub 70. And so I think it's a good adjustment to be made. But, you know, Smoke and Hope, one of the fastest stages out there in terms of a peak time. I think it is the fastest, whether it's a rimfire rifle open or rimfire pistol open. It's 7 seconds. So the peak time per string, Jeff, is 1.75 seconds. So that's blistering. So to become a GM, you need to be right about 1.837, so 1.84 seconds to have a GM run on Smoke and Hope.
Definitely. Well, moving on here to the Rimfire Rifle Iron Division, a gun that I've picked up in the past couple of months. I know it's one that you've shot for a while. This is getting 3.5 seconds of change. The one stage that's not changing is Outer Limits. All the other stages, though, are getting a half-second change. And I think, again, more and more people shooting this division, getting faster, training to go faster, is calling this drive down in the times.
Yeah, I think all those are appropriate changes. It's interesting. I think I actually shoot my iron sight gun maybe just a dash quicker on Smoke and Hope than my open gun. But, you know, Outer Limits at 12 and a half seconds with an iron sight rifle, there's definitely a couple of folks out there that can shoot it quicker than 12 and a half. But I think that's a pretty good number.
You know, you bring up a really good point. And one of the things that we did when analyzing this data was it just wasn't taking all the times. We actually looked at the people who were making the peak time, and there had to be a appropriate percentage of people in the division that were above Grandmaster, meaning they were shooting the peak time or faster. And then we did some math on those. And the reason we did it that way is because those are the people that are pushing speed.
Right.
It's wonderful that there's more and more people shooting the sport, but no offense to the D shooter out there, you're not really impacting the peak times. It's the people who are making Grandmaster. And I actually vied for bringing it to the everybody who is 95%. And they convinced me that, no, we need to make it 100%. And that's what we did. And I think these changes, some of them are tough, but I think, as we've talked about it, they're very appropriate. It's going to make the sport a little tougher, but that Grandmaster is going to mean a lot more when you make it.
Yeah, and Jeff, when you're looking at the data, and we'll go through the other divisions here in just a second or two. When you were looking at the data, what would you say the percentage per division you saw as a Grandmaster for each division as a percentage of the total people classified in that particular division?
You know, Steve, we did this analysis a couple of months ago, and I haven't looked at that, but that's a great question, and it's one that I'm going to have an answer for you at the next podcast.
Okay.
Fortunately, I don't have those numbers. Will tell you that, again, why isn't Carry Optics, PCC Iron, and Single Stack in there? And it's for just that reason. There just weren't enough Grandmasters to warrant a change in the times.
And the last time I looked at it, Jeff, and again, it's been a while ago, I think what you would see when you talk about a Grandmaster-level shooter is you're within the top 5%. Or so. I know it can vary depending on how popular a division is, but typically when you look at what the percentage of classification is for a division, it's usually 5% or less. And so people that are a Grandmaster, you're in that top couple of percent of everybody that are shooting a particular division. So that's something that you should take pride in, and also something you should aspire to.
Right. Well, one thing you should I should point out too is all the data that we used came from World Speed Shoots or other major matches that we decided. Now, a lot of people will make Grandmaster, and they do great, and they never shoot a major. they've done the work, and that's great, but their times would not be considered in this. Gotcha. We only took World Speed Shoot and majors into account, figuring that's where the best of the best are. That's where we're going to base the numbers on.
You know, Jeff, to that point, to talk about that or expound upon that just a little bit more, you know, it is very different when the timer goes off at the World Speed Shoot than at the Griffin Gun Club. It's it's a little bit different different experience.
A little less pressure.
A little bit, yeah. A little bit.
Okay, well, rounding out our last two divisions is our Rimfire Pistol divisions. Why don't you take open?
Hey, Rimfire Pistol Open is the fastest division of the 13 that are for classification. And so, you know, most of the stages went down half a second. Besides Outer Limits, it went up half of a second, which is probably appropriate. But the total time went from 73.5 to 70.5. And so that's a pretty assertive number. So, Jeff, why do you think that Rimfire Pistol Open is faster than the Rimfire Rifle Open division?
Right now, I think it's... I think there's more people that are accustomed to shooting a pistol than a rifle. Mm-hmm. I think that for most shooters, until they get extremely proficient with the rifle, that they can transition a pistol faster than they can a rifle.
Sure.
I think over time, working with a rifle, you can learn to transition that better. But when you look at a stage like Roundabout or Showdown, we've discussed Showdown, how it's one of the fastest transitioning stages out there. I think the rifle and the pistol are on par. But when you get a stage like Accelerator, got a very wide transition, I think the pistol actually has a little bit of an advantage. And I think the numbers show that. You know, the numbers are going for pistol, they're going down to 8.5, and rifle still get 9, or gonna go to 9. So the pistol, I think it comes down to being able to transition it faster. Now, as I said, I think more people shooting more rifle, that may change. But right now, I think that's my reason. What do you think?
No, I agree. I think some of the fastest shooters in Steel Challenge really are based in centerfire, you know, the Max, BJ, KC, and they're really good handgun shooters. And we talked about this on a previous podcast that Casey shot a 60-point-something rimfire pistol open, and that's the fastest time that I've ever seen shot in Steel Challenge in rimfire pistol open. And then Ethan is one of the fastest, if not the fastest, that I've seen. Cole Bush has thrown down some 65s, and we've got, you know, Cole B shot 65, 66, but Ethan shot a 64, and so that's the fastest time that I've shot. So if I use that as a baseline, that rimfire pistol opens a couple seconds quicker than rimfire rifle open, the results show that. And so I think it's appropriate, but I think also what's going to happen here in the next maybe 2 years is that gap's going to close even more. I think that there will be a handful of rifle shooters that will be closing in on, you know, that low 60 range, maybe right at 60. It'll be interesting to see if it'll be a rifle or a pistol that will break 60 seconds first. But there's some fast people out there working on it.
We mentioned on an earlier podcast that, you know, there was the very small, limited group of people that was the under 70 club. And now the under 70 club is filled, and it's like, if you're not under 67, that seems to be the new low bar, you know, where the... those top shooters are hanging out in both pistol and rifle, right, in the rimfire division.
I was just going to share with you something very interesting happened this past weekend. Sorry for the aside.
I know.
You know how we were talking about the Smoke and Hope versus Showdown versus Roundabout and what's faster, and I was sharing my classifications are within 0.02 seconds with all three. So what I did is I changed a couple things on Smoke and Hope, shot it in the same order that I always do, 1, 2, 3, 4, but I changed a little bit of my sight alignment and, you know, being more sight focus and compared to target focus, because I thought target focus was faster at 1, 2, 3, 4. And then I changed it up to be a little bit more sight focused. And last weekend, if the results get uploaded, with my rimfire rifle open gun, I dropped almost a third of a second. So I
went from,
right around that 640, 650 range, I shot a 612. So hopefully those results get submitted. And now that will be my fastest stage. So now I need to apply some of those same concepts to a couple of the other stages and see if I can get them down in that range. But I was pretty stoked about that.
You know, I was working with a shooter on Monday, and we were practicing smoke and hope. And I was trying to get him to understand, you know, I had him shoot about 10 strings without any, you know, teaching of him anything yet, and just had him look at the plates. And, you know, his shots on plate, he was shooting it 3-4-1-2 stop. That's how I shoot it. That's how he wanted to shoot it. I said, great, we'll work on that. And, you know, I was showing him on plate one, his hits were all over the plate. If you if you broke the plate into quadrants, there were hits in every quadrant. And I said, you know, you really want to be looking at that lower left quadrant. Burn your eyes laser focused on a dot in that lower left quadrant. And when he started doing that, one, he was more consistent in his times on his first shot. And he was much faster, and that's just physics. He wasn't moving the gun far, as far.
Right.
You know, at the level that, that you and many others are shooting at, it's those little things that can really make a difference.
And I think for me, what also happened is it's, and I know you and I've talked about it, maybe not on a podcast, is you have to shoot fast. I mean, you have to get past that first time that you take out your mom and dad's car, and you go, you know, maybe slightly over the speed limit. The first time you do it, we won't get into numbers because plausible deniability, but, you know, you got that, let's just call it the pucker factor, and it's an experience going that fast. And I think once you get past that, you're able to control, like in that situation with your parents' car, you're able to control it a lot more, and you're going a lot faster. So the new fast seems normal, and I think that helps you push the limits. And I know it helps train your eyes and your brain to be able to see faster in order to shoot faster. And again, it's one of those that time starts to slow down because the fast is now the new average. So.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I couldn't agree more. I mean, you term I always use is you have to feel what it's like to go fast, or you can't be afraid to go fast. Maybe that's a better way of putting it. And it's not a fear as in, oh my God, I'm scared. No, it's that you trust your training. You trust your subconscious shooting to the point where you're not worried. You know, you can go that fast, you know, and if you miss, you're not worried about it because you know that your training is going to let you finish the rest of the strings without a problem.
Sure.
And it's, you know, you can call it confidence. You can call it cockiness. If you go to a match prepared, you shoot your best and you'll be fine. All right. Well, the last one, rimfire pistol iron. Again, this is the one where I'm going to be a 93% GM, which is going to bug me until I get to a match and work on fixing that. But again, 3.5 second changes there. Again, a lot of people shooting rimfire pistol iron, and it's showing by the numbers requiring a change.
And you know that, Jeff, that's actually a division that I coach a lot of people to start shooting. You know, there's a lot of junior shooters that I work with, and they always ask me, hey, do I need to be shooting a dot and a comp to be fast? And no. You really need to focus on the fundamentals, and rimfire pistol iron is one of the best divisions to do that in learning how to shoot a handgun. It's something that you focus on the fundamentals, very transferable skills once you shoot with a red dot. And I tend to shoot a lot of iron sights to help my game when I'm shooting a dot, because, you know, if you're doing the fundamentals right on an iron sight, you can get away with a little bit more shooting an open gun. But being grounded on those fundamentals is extremely important if you're looking to step your game up in shooting. So it's a great division. I think that is getting a little bit quicker. Hopefully more and more people shoot rimfire pistol iron. I know I'm going to start shooting a little bit more of it next year. I shot a lot of it last year, kind of backed away from that this year. Now that I'm shooting more single stack, still an iron sight gun, but I think, I'm going to have to check my classification times. You know, 'cause it's gotta be at 100%, Jeff.
I'm sure there's a lot of people doing math. You know, I know the guys that are, and gals that are GMs, you know, like to see that not only get a GM, but then be that 100% GM and a little badge of honor there. And I know for me, having that RFPI drop down below 95, it's going to get shot. And right. Your point, it's you're absolutely correct. I couldn't agree more with everything you just said. You know, it's, you've got that, the basic fundamentals of marksmanship, sight, trigger pull, grip. And it's a lot easier to learn that on a rimfire gun than it is on a centerfire gun, but it's a very transferable skill once you have it in the rimfire range.
All right, I just pulled up my classification, Jeff. Rimfire pistol iron, it's going down to a 81. All right, we're still good.
That's awesome.
Not by
That's
much, awesome. But we're still good. That's all that matters.
All right, everybody. Well, this was really an impromptu thing. Steve and I are doing this a little differently tonight. It's not our normal time to do this, but this is the same day that these new peak times came out. It's about 10:45, almost my bedtime. But Steve and I felt we wanted to get our opinions out there on this. And if you guys have any opinions, please put them on the Steel Target Paint podcast page. I reposted the news brief, and we'd like to hear what you've got to say. Steve, any parting words?
Jeff, thank you to yourself as well as Zach Jones for putting in the time and effort. I know you just talking about culling through all that data, I got a little bit sleepy, but I appreciate you guys going through that to help raise the bar of our game. And before we go, Jeff, I just want to thank Steel Target Paint for allowing us to do this podcast.
Beautiful.
No, Jeff, you're beautiful. All right, everybody, have a great night.
Good night, everybody.